I've just come off of the greatest meditation ever, hours and hours. So I'm in the full stop in the now of this wow. The clarification was so tremendous. It's just, it's just huge wow. So instead of trying to force things and keep going, force it. No, just take it easy for a little while. So I'm in the mode of taking it a little bit easy here. Maybe I can just talk about a few things along the way here. That whatever comes up. First of all, the Holy Spirit has actually followed all paths all the way to the end where they're not needed anymore. And everyone, all paths have already been released. In other words, everyone is already cured. And this was done in an instant, just one instant. So, everyone has already been totally cured, meaning they've reached the point where they've relinquished it. They feel no more need for this scenario where it seems that they can work on disempowerment. They realize, oh, I don't need the delusion of time, space, process, or form. I don't need the delusion of perception anymore. They've had healed perception, and then they've released even the healed perception for direct, total, all-in-one direct experiencing, which we cannot even imagine, so we don't even try. So this already happened in an instant. It's already happened. As soon as God blessed the blessed spirit, this blessing we call the Holy Spirit, in an instant it was all accomplished. And it's not always easy to put clarity into words. It's not always easy, so I try not to struggle with it. If it starts to struggle, just drop it. So you're entitled to drop. In fact, you're entitled to drop this whole scenario of existence if you want. Now, the goal. This very streamlined, delay-saving approach, the ultimate goal of all approaches, is to see the root of our situation just as it is, not trying to rationalize it at all, just seeing as it is, and just the seeing that Jesus tells us, the seeing illusion just as it is, evaporates it. And seeing illusion just as it is, seeing the root of our so-called struggle or travails, you see it's completely absurd. And so that's why we say seeing it as it is without trying to rationalize it, because we don't want to admit it's absurd, so we try to make it serious. have a very serious problem. Well, the serious problem we have is not really a serious problem, it's a severe problem, which is the continuity problem. It's not a real problem, it's a practical problem we have that will evaporate once we are able to see the root of our travails just as it is, which is essentially what we did. Is we tried to disempower God. We had a whim. I said, let's try that. Let's see if we can be greater than God. We can't disempower God. So in order to honor our creativity, we play this little game. And we said, well, we're going to say that God created us with a specific, special intent, and that is to disempower God. And that's our life, that's our purpose. And God, this is what God wants us to do. This is how we framed it, you know. And then we say, if we fail to disempower God, then God will annihilate us, because we've turned out to be a stillborn creation that is incapable of doing what God created it to do. So this is the little game we're playing, and why we feel so trapped is we feel if we don't disempower God, God will annihilate us. we can just look at this. Okay. And this is what is causing us all these troubles. So how do we work on disempowering God through this world and bodies? And then, of course, we claim that God created this world and bodies, so we could work on disempowering God. And this is also not true. We have made all this world and bodies, so we could believe it's possible to disempower God, that we're working on it. We say, God, don't annihilate us yet. We're still working on it. We're still working on death and sickness and disempowerment, so don't annihilate us. So we feel that this world and bodies is essential to keep us from being annihilated, actually, because without the world and bodies, it would be apparent that we cannot disempower God. And then we think God would look at us and say, oh, you failed. You completely failed at what I created you for. So you're a bad creation. I'm going to get rid of you. And so now in Christianity, for example, the misinterpretation of Jesus coming here is that in our fear, we interpret that meaning as, oh, God loves us so much and doesn't want to annihilate us. Okay, so God showed us the disempowerment, and actually gave us the disempowerment of God, so that now we can, if we claim that we've succeeded in disempowering God through the death of Jesus, that God will say, oh, okay, I'm not going to annihilate you. So you're saved from God's wrath, from God's desire to annihilate you. And this is the way that it's been interpreted. Misinterpreted, actually. But understandably so, because of our situation. What Jesus came really to say here is that God is love. God is not angry. God did not tell us we have to do this, have to annihilate God. What Jesus came in this world as, and moving about with a body, is to say that, look, all these forms, all this, it's okay that you have all this different forms of disempowerment, including death. That's all okay. Right? God still loves you, even though you're trying to annihilate God. You can't, and God still loves you, even though you're trying to do that. It's okay. And you can keep this stuff as long as you want. It's okay. God is love. There's no anger towards us, no threat. God is not threatened at all. And there's none of these forms of disempowerment work at all. So don't worry. But it's understandable. It's like a brake on a car. We want to hit the brake. We want to feel like, yeah, we have this means to disempower God, this world, this universe, these bodies. God's not trying to take that away from us, you see? So Jesus came in the world and says, look, God's not even trying to take death away from you, okay? God's not trying to take any of this away from us. This is what Jesus was showing. He's not trying to take this away. You can keep it as long as you want. You can keep death, attack and suffering, misery, sickness, everything, all this apparent disempowerment, the symbolization of disempowerment. You can keep it all as long as you want. God is not trying to take it away from you. But there's a path to salvation. And you don't have to keep it. You can realize the absurdity of what you've done and how we play a little game, a little trick on ourselves, really. So Jesus proved that God is not trying to take this away by coming here, living a life in this world that didn't need to play with this symbols of disempowerment, but he came here, okay, and showed you even death, you know, even cruel death. You know, God's not trying to even take even cruel death away from you, because that's something that you really cling to, like, maybe that's disempowerment. Maybe we found a way to carry out God's so-called mission for us, you know. So Jesus allowed us to play this out and say, look, God's not even trying to take that away from you. None of it. We're free to keep on playing with this silliness for as long, forever if we want to, really. But God knows that we don't really want to keep playing with it forever. So God's showing us the path of salvation, saying, hey, there's a way. Just need to get your attention. Just look at it as it is. look at the silliness just as silliness. That's recognize silliness as silliness. That's it. Instead of trying to, rationalize it, sacralize it. So this world is like a brake on a car that whenever you want to slow down, you know, we start waking up, and, you know, realizing, say, whoa, okay, we're caught in the, we need to slow down. The world acts like a brake for us, so we're happy to have the brake. The only problem is it comes when we deify the brake, try to deify the brake and say, the brake is God, you know, this world is God, the brake is God, braking is God, try to deify it. Which we all most try to do. That way we think it's permanent. It's inherently permanent. We get, you know, well, it's not permanent. It's endless in that we can always have it if we want. But it's not permanent in that God is stipulating that this is what we must have. Because remember, God created us as perfectly free. So there's no stipulation as what we experience at all. None. So it both is and it isn't. In those terms, it's always pure potential. All is pure potential. So it's always a potential, this situation, sure. As are all other experiences. All other experiences are also pure potential, all endlessly. But there is no specification. So when we deify this, that we're making this big mistake as saying, this is specified for us. It's not. We're specifying it for ourselves. God is not specifying it for us. This is the crucial, one of the, you know, crucial mistakes we need to look at. But it's a tough one because we feel it's so essential. We feel if we don't figure out how to annihilate God, we're going to be annihilated. So we want to feel like we have this laboratory for as long as we need it, until we finally figure it out. And therefore, if it makes us feel safe, if we stipulate that God has, this is God created this just for us, and this is our home forever, you know, and this is it for us, this is it, that makes us feel safer, right? At least it seems to, but it doesn't quite work out that way. It's like defenses don't quite work out the way they have unintended consequences, actually. But all you need to do, anyone needs to do, is just be able to look at this with a smile and a laugh and a chuckle. Just look at it and say, just as it is. Don't need to do anything else. Just notice it. Just be aware as it is, this silliness, and say, oh, okay. Don't have to get rid of it, don't have to do anything. Just see it as it is. That's the most important aspect. Oh, okay, we've tried to deify, we've tried to say God made this world in bodies. To try and deify it, meaning this is what God has stipulated. So it's inherently always be here. Inherently so, without us, whether we want it or not, it will remain, you know, and that's not true. See, that's not true. But that makes us feel like we'll be able to always be able to here to work on this. Well, it's a half-truth because it will be here as long as we want it to be here. But we won't always want it to be here because we won't need it. We realize, oh, I was just playing this silly little game on myself. You know? Okay, don't need that. Don't need it anymore. Don't need the world anymore. As Jesus says, God is not a designer of universes. Our worlds, that is not God. God is the designer of pure potential, of endless eternal life, pure potential that is always, any experience can manifest, and any experience cannot manifest, always. We can manifest multiple universes instantly, and then the next instant have them unmanifest instantly. And that does not cause even the slightest ripple in pure potential. No residue, no ripple. But we don't need to try and imagine this at all. We're just pointing out that God is not a designer of universes. It doesn't structure experiencing. We desire for experiencing, and that experiencing arises. But its structure is always, quote unquote, you call it emptiness, or it doesn't have any real structure, because its structure is actually pure potential. Always. The structure of everything is always pure potential. That's all. That's the only structure there is, which is really all structure and no structure, no specific structure, but all structure. So all is eternal life. This very moment, all is eternal life. That is the structure of everything, is eternal life. Pure potential is the structure of everything, just like the form of everything is clear light, totally clear light. Not a void, but a no determinate structure whatsoever. And some like to hear this type of talk, and some aren't so interested. So I go from one, sort of wander here and there, you know, and this wander here and there, touching on various aspects, and whatever helps trigger, you know, the wow, that's good. And then just say, okay, wow, that's great. Just recognize the wow, and full stop in the wow. Seeing it just as it is. Ah, okay. This is what Jesus says, just see illusion as it is. And then you'll recognize the options you have. But if you try to change illusion into something it's not, that's where we get trapped. Is where we try to make illusions real and then to try to defeat them, this is the problem. This is called duality. This is what deceives us, keeps us struggling. Now, when you get this wow feeling, one of the ways, sometimes we don't recognize it. One of the ways of recognizing it is if you find your thoughts going in a chain of thinking about how successful you're going to be in helping others and all that, immediately you should realize that you're feeling slightly overwhelmed, because you're having a fantasy of being in control and being a great teacher, which means that right now you're feeling like, wow, I've just been bowled over by the great news, the good news is just, and I'm struggling to regain some equilibrium, so I'm having a fantasy of being some very successful teacher or helper or bodhisattva or savior or something. So immediately drop the storyline of the great bodhisattva-ness, you know, or the great savior-ness, the great guru-ness. Just drop it. Don't follow that storyline. Oh, that's not the vision I want. Just drop it. And get back, say, oh, I must have a severe, my continuity problem right here is kicking up very severely. It means I must have really triggered some great good news. And let me stay with this more directly. By not imagining any successful scenario at all. The success comes with staying with this directly. Checking in with how you feel about the great good news directly. And not disassociating from it and spinning off some fantasy of savior bodhisattva guru-ness. So, that's one way to get recentered quickly. Because the mind has all these little tricks, you know, to re-empower yourself after you've seen the absurdity of it. We think, whoa, I need to re-empower the world. And we're very sneaky about it. We say, no, I need to help everybody out, you know. This is how I'm going to, that's really re-empowering the world. Trying to re-empower the world when we've seen that there's no necessity for it whatsoever. It's all based on absurdity. For ourselves. Now, for others, of course, they are empowering their world. Is to Our job is to realize we don't need the world. But others are free to keep this fantasy going as long as they want to. But we want to be free of feeling that we need to keep it going for ourselves. We don't need to keep it going. So when we get scared, we want to hold on to the world. We often try to combine the two and say, okay, I'm going to be a great savior. I'm going to go help everybody and cure this and do this and this and this. That's a clever way of trying to re-empower the world, you know, the belief that you need it. The sun is coming out here. So go right back. It's a continuity fear that's kicking up. It's a wow that's kicking up. It is really a wow. And we often miss the wow. We're not aware of it, but it's there. So check in and say, hey, maybe I've made so much progress that I'm just astonished by it, actually. And this is true. This morning I made so much progress and so much clarity that is immeasurable. I couldn't, it was just astonishing. So of course I'm going to feel, it's like you're in a car doing 100 miles an hour. And you think you're going fast, and then someone on the Autobahn blows past you at 200, and you're just like, wow. Wow. Whoa, I thought I was going fast, and now I'm going really fast. Yeah. We've probably all had that experience on a freeway or something, but we're going pretty fast, you know, I think we're going fast. And someone just goes past us like we're standing still. Whoa, we say, whoa, that's fast. So, yesterday I thought I was going really fast. And then this morning, I just blew by, like, going like so much faster. It's just like, huh. And how? Because I was able to look at the root of this whole situation and see it and just laugh. I didn't forget to laugh. Jesus says the ending comes when you remember to laugh at it. That's all. That's how it ends. And he says the whole problem is you forgot to laugh at the silliness of it. You took it seriously. No, you tried to rationalize it and make it serious. I said, well, I got a serious problem here. We don't have any problem at all. But we forgot to just laugh and say how silly it is. If I don't annihilate God, God's going to annihilate me. If I don't learn to annihilate God, that's God's mission for me. If I don't do that, God will be so angry that God will then annihilate me. As if God's happiness and the purpose of creation was to annihilate itself. And if we don't carry out the purpose of creation annihilating itself, then creation will be so angry that then it will annihilate itself. You see? This is literally the silliness of our situation. The entire situation we're in is rests upon this silliness, actually. Again, we believe our belief system really is that the reason creation created itself, so to speak, is here. Its purpose is to annihilate itself. And if it's unable to annihilate itself, it'll be so angry about this that it will annihilate itself. Can't win, huh? Can't win. It's a can't win scenario. And from this scenario, creation is completely doomed, right? There's no way around it. And this is our belief system. But if we keep thinking, no, wait a minute, we can forestall this annihilation if we just figure out a way to annihilate creation. But then we say, wait a minute, if I figure out a way to annihilate creation, I annihilate it. How is that forestalling the annihilation of creation? You know, it's like, so we say, there's some, you know, something doesn't quite add up here. And this is the burden that we carry. It's like we're really serious, thinking that we're forestalling annihilation. But in the back of our minds, say, well, but wait a minute, if I'm working on figuring out a way to annihilate creation, how am I forestalling it? I haven't quite got it yet, you know. So this world and bodies and stuff is like our waves of working on annihilation, but not quite getting it yet. You know, so we don't quite, haven't quite figured it out yet. We gotta keep working on it. But it's a real head scratcher. You know, we're always sort of feel like, it doesn't quite make sense. You know, it doesn't quite. This whole scenario doesn't quite make sense. We feel it. Of course it doesn't. It's completely ludicrous. Completely ludicrous. But as soon as we don't see it as completely ludicrous, that right away, we try to make sense of it. And we are in a dream, essentially, where we're lost. We're lost. We're lost in this effort, you know, to make it serious. I gotta be serious about this. This is a serious situation. Got a serious situation. And so we're in this duality of seriousness and non-seriousness. We're trying, you know, we don't want to take it too seriously because we might annihilate ourselves. Wait a minute. But we don't want to not take it seriously because we also feel, well, God will annihilate us if we don't take it seriously. And then we start thinking, well, maybe God's crazy. You know, it's like, but we're not sure, you know. And it's the ocean of samsara, as they call it. The ocean is just like, you know, waves of fear and doubt and uncertainty. Am I crazy or is God crazy? Or is God, you know, how serious do I need to take it? I don't want to take it too seriously. And so we're just juggling, you know, this whole thing is very fragile. It's a house of cards or something. So basically this whole situation is like a house of cards, and the slightest little breeze, the whole thing starts falling down and we get all freaked out. But if we can just look at it, the absurdity is completely ludicrous. Then where's the freak out? There's no freak out. So in listening and hearing what Jesus has to say, and I can tell that he's looking at all this and sees it clearly, but it's not freaking out at all. And so that's very reassuring. You say, hey. And he says, you can do it too. You won't freak out either. Believe me, if you just look at it and don't forget to laugh. If you forget to laugh, then for sure you will freak out. Yeah. Or just a chuckle, you know, it's just silly. And that's the only difference between those who seem to be lost in this vast ocean of ups and downs, conditioned existence, samsara. The only difference between those and the saviors, the bodhisattvas, the gurus, etc., is the ones who are free of this all have just looked and laughed, chuckled, and didn't, you know, they said, how silly. Yeah, and that's it. That's the only difference. And the ones who forgot to laugh are the ones who are, you know, in this, feel like they're just, have this vast ocean of ups and downs, and they're, you have to tackle this ocean, they have to go out in this ocean and brave this ocean, you know. Oh, it's horrible. It is absolutely horrible. But it doesn't get any better by making it serious, like I have a real problem here, and then solving the real problem. There is no real problem. There never will be a real problem. There is a pragmatic, practical, temporary problem called the continuity problem. But it's not a real problem. It's not a real problem. It's not a problem with reality. It's a familiarity issue, is what it is. It's an issue, a familiarity issue. Like, wow, the good news is so great, I can't quite tolerate it yet. But it's not a real problem. It's a severe problem, not a real problem. And just looking at it like that, and when you accept that, it's like you've repented and you realize, I'm going to be saved. I really am going to get free of this vast ocean, unpredictable, treacherous, up and down, choppy wave, this horrible ocean that we we feel is tossing and turning us throughout eternity. You know, we feel like, and we think this is our home. We have to somehow get used to it, that this is real, and we got to, you know, smooth it out somehow, but we can't figure out how to smooth it out, and it's just driving us crazy. You know? We realize, oh, I'm going to be free of that. No question about it. No question. I just need to get this familiarity issue. I just need to work on it. That's it. Just a familiarity issue is all you need to, anyone needs to work on. There's no real problem at all. The last thing that anybody wants in this world, which is the belief that finding a way to annihilate God, reality, is possible. The last thing they want is it to be smoked out. And the problem is to be eliminated. Oh no. That will have a rebound effect. You know, the last thing they want is to have all those problems cured, you know? No way. Because they say, okay, well wait a minute. They say, if I don't find a way to annihilate and disempower reality, God, myself, God's going to annihilate me. Oh my gosh, I got, you know, what happened to my problems? What happened to my sickness? What happened? Come back, please, you know. It's like that. So the remedy for sicknesses, illnesses, problems is not to try and say, I'm here to take, you know, to cure you. No, 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 no. That makes it worse. Thank the problems. Thank you for being here. Thank the world. Thank you for being such a wonderful prop, you know. For reassuring me that maybe there is a way. Maybe, you know, these problems that we made all these problems for ourselves. So thank him for coming here, for being with us, and then now thank him for leaving. Say, you can go in the corner there for a while. Lazy man's guide to enlightenment, shortcut, thank everything just the way it is. That's the first step. That is true. That is very true. Very, very true. You see, we think that these problems that we have are preventing us from being annihilated. So, and we're the author of all this. This is just our creativity. All these problems are simply our creativity. And this is how we're expressing our creativity, by imagining all these problems for ourselves so we feel like we can say to God, hey God, I'm working on annihilation. Don't annihilate me yet. Don't be mad. I'm still working on figuring out a way to disempower myself, which is God. I'm still working on a way to disempower you. Don't worry. Look at this. I've got a body. You've got a world. Everything's dying in the world. Look at this. I'm here. I'm in this world, God. So I'm not giving up yet, you know? So thank all this world and all these problems. Thank our creativity for providing this for us. Be grateful, you know, for the problems. Say thank you so much for being here. And when you do that, it lightens you up very significantly. Slips the script entirely. You just feel, wow. I had this guided meditation this morning where what I did was I hugged every single one of my past body incarnations and thank you so much. You did a great job for me. And it went one by one. I hugged them all. And then I hugged the whole world. I said, thank you, world, for you did such a great job. Because I was like totally freaked out and afraid that I'm going to be annihilated because I can't figure out a way to annihilate, disempower God. So you gave me this feeling like maybe I can do it, you know, maybe there is a way. And that, you know, reassured me for a long time. So thank the world, praise all the body, praise death, praise sickness, praise all that. Thank you, because it's all our own creativity, which we simply fashioned. We asked for the living light to fashion this for us, and it did, so that we could feel like we're not going to be annihilated. This is why. So I don't come into the world saying, I'm going to get rid of death, I'm going to cure cancer, I'm going to do all... That is not the way. That is not the way at all. That makes things worse. Come into the world and say... And say, hey, this is how you do it. This is... Thank this appearance. Thank this appearance. All of this. It was a needed crutch, something I needed for a long time. One moment. Okay. So as amazing as it sounds, the way is to thank death, thank sickness, thank all your troubles. Truly be grateful. Have this great gratitude which I'm having now. I'm able to do this. Because it's really our creativity. We use our creativity in an extraordinary way to what we thought was prevent us from being annihilated. And so these are actually our dear friends that we've had for so long. Sickness, death, bodies, aging, all the traumas and struggles, everything. So when we're able to look at it this way, and just with great gratitude, you know, and love and gratitude. Thank all those deaths for showing up. Because all this time we believed that if they didn't show up, we would be annihilated, destroyed, tortured by God and destroyed. Now, we know now we don't need him to keep showing up. We don't need the death and sickness and aging and the world as we see it and the troubles. We don't need them to show up anymore for us. So we can allow the gratitude and love comes first. And the feeling of empowerment that, hey, I really did do this, all this to myself because I felt I needed to. The blame is gone. You're forgiving yourself is what it is. And Jesus says the key to salvation is forgiveness. But it's forgiving yourself. Which means to have a love and gratitude for everything that you've been experiencing. For them showing up. Thanks for showing up. Thanks for showing up. Very much did a great job in showing up. And what I do is I hug the entire world, everything that's ever shown up, every form that's ever shown up, everything. I just give it a big hug. Say, thank you, thank you, thank you. From the microbes, you know, to just everything. Thank you for all showing up. This is just gratitude for it all. This is what's important. So getting to this is important for us, for sure. All this other stuff is just side trips, you know, and we just need to just drop them. Is practice dropping your train of thought, okay? Drop your train of thought in other directions. Forgiving ourselves for torturing ourselves all this time, because... So thank the torture, in other words. Thank the torture. Thank you for... Great job, because that's just, it's just an appearance that we desired. It wasn't something outside of us. It's our own imagining, his own desire for it. But now we see, I don't need to do that anymore. But if we condemn our own creativity, we'll be afraid to drop this and go on to something else, right? Because we'll feel that our creativity stands condemned, and it won't. Therefore, is not functioning properly. It will not respond properly. So the first step we have to take is to lift the condemnation of ourselves, of our own creativity. So we no longer stand condemned in our own eyes, you see, in our own being. And we most certainly can't do this. I'm doing it right now, and I'm able to do this to a certain extent. This problem of suffering, it's so terrible. It's double suffering. I think all suffering is like double suffering because we have the suffering and we hate it so much, and that makes us suffer. It makes us even more frightened because we say, my God, I want to get rid of this suffering. But if I do, I might be annihilated. So suffering, not only is suffering to feel terrible for us, but it also brings up the fear of annihilation because we don't really want it. You see? We think, I need this, but I want to get rid of it. And so it brings up this terrible conflict and suffering for us. It's horrible, isn't it? We're just looking for a form of suffering that we don't want to get rid of, you know. That's what the world is looking for. Can't we have some way of working on disempowerment and annihilation that we don't want to get rid of? That we say, yeah, I really love this. This is what I want to keep. But no, you know, we always want to say, wow, I really want to feel better than this. You know, I might be annihilated. I think I'm going to be annihilated. So if we don't laugh at the silliness of this, then it's a very nasty trap. So certainly we recognize it is a very nasty trap, but the remedy is to laugh. Laugh at the silliness of it, actually. If I don't annihilate God, then God will be annihilated, you know, is one way of putting it. Or if I don't annihilate God, God will annihilate me, you know. God created me to annihilate God, and if I don't annihilate God, then God will be so angry at me, God's going to annihilate me. Again, total silliness. So it's inherently silly, and if we don't see the silliness of it, then we feel we're caught in a very nasty trap. Exceedingly nasty, because the way that we try to work on disempowerment, disempowering ourselves, is terribly suffering, and we don't want it. And this feeling of not wanting this makes us fear annihilation. So the way that throws us back into even greater efforts of more suffering, which we don't want, which makes us fear annihilation even more. So it's this vicious circle. It's a vicious circle, actually, very vicious circle. But again, the remedy is not to take it more seriously. It's to not take it seriously at all. If we take it seriously even a little bit, that vicious circle is there. There's no seriousness, no truth to it whatsoever. It's completely silly. God does not specify what we have to experience. Only that we're free, totally free. That's it. And God is the pure potentiality that enables all experiencing to take place, to be experienced. So it's totally silly to claim that we have some mission. We have to do this. We have to figure out how to disempower God. This is just, again, our desire to be greater than God, really, which is impossible. It's like saying that pure potential is not pure potential. That there's some determinant experience that pure potential says, well, no, you have to have this. And then everything, you're free to have everything else, but this experience you have to have. This is not true. There isn't any, God doesn't have any preferences as for what we have to experience or should be experiencing. So this is very crucial information to unravel this knot of samsara, suffering, of misery, of this feeling of hell. It's so nasty, this double bind we're in. We're in a double bind. It is so nasty. Saying that it's hell is a kind way of putting it, really. And everybody's just looking for a little calm patch of water somewhere, you know, in this vast ocean. They look around, they feel like there's this vast ocean of freak outness, potential freak outness everywhere. and they're looking, just trying to find a little place where it's not so topsy-turvy, you know, and it's just And everybody's searching for that place. They're searching for that home. You know, that place. Okay, maybe this home is the place. And then it turns out, oh, it's not. Okay, let me sell this home. Let's go get another home. Oh, that's not it either. Let's move to a different state. Let's move to a different country. Where is it? You know, let's get a different car. This one's nice, but I still feel, you know. And they're always searching, compulsively looking for, how do I find some peace of mind in this nasty double bind? First, recognize it is a nasty double bind. Let's be honest here. It is absolutely nasty. Nobody wants it. And yet to say we don't want it freaks us out. Right? We say, wait. No. I need the suffering. I just don't want suffering to be suffering, is what we say. And yet that never works for us, does it? So we keep looking for some other body, some other life, some other place where the suffering is not so bad, you know. And the double bind is always there because of the suffering is not so bad. We say, now wait a minute, you know. I don't think I figured out a way to annihilate God, so I'm going to be annihilated. I better suffer a little more here. And then you suffer more, and you say, oh, that's too much. And then you say, well, wait a minute. I haven't found the way, and I want to get rid of suffering. Oh, the fear of annihilation arises. So this dreadful ocean of anxiety, really, we're floating on this dreadful ocean, most dreadful ocean. And it's all completely fake, completely unreal, completely fake. Completely silly at its very root. So of course everybody's screaming, help, 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 help. Where can I find peace of mind? Where in this ocean, where on this ocean can I find peace of mind? There's nowhere on this ocean that you can find peace of mind. It's like saying, you know, the problem is real, but where can I find some shelter from this real problem? The shelter is that there is no problem. Don't need this ocean anymore. You don't make the ocean real, but find a calm place on the ocean. You realize that this is all absurd. There is no problem. You don't need the ocean. Therefore, you don't need the ocean. You don't need to figure out how to disempower yourself. So you don't need this plausible scenario of how to work on it, or maybe there might be a way to find it. This world's like, it seems like, well, there might be a way here, you know. Maybe there's a way if we just, you know, investigate it properly. We don't need that. Don't need the ocean. And then, of course, we're not familiar with this sort of talk, so we have to get familiar with it. But I guarantee you, you can get familiar with it. It just takes a while. But most people don't even start. They're so freaked out by the ocean, you know, that they say, I'm too busy, I'm too busy, I'm too busy, I got to somehow. Find what I'm searching for somehow. And like that. So it's very difficult to discipline yourself to hear enough so familiarity starts taking place. Most people's in one ear and out the other, and familiarity really doesn't take place. It's only when you stop and wow, and you stop right there and say, wait, wow, what did I just hear? What I just heard just was wow. Then that's when you start getting familiar. So you say, let me get familiar with this. That's the path. That is a spiritual path. Most people are so freaked out by the ocean and the situation that they don't get started. But what helps is those who are free of this dilemma, and remember to laugh and say how silly it all is. You see them and you say, "Wow, it's possible." I remember the first time I ever played golf. I didn't know how to play at all. I'd never even done anything. And someone I was working with at the time said, "Hey, I feel like playing golf today. Let's go play golf. I don't feel like working today." I said, "Well, okay." Whatever, I don't know. And I think he had some clubs that I could use, or I rented some or something. And then I had no idea. What is this? I don't know how to play golf. So I proceeded to just, you know, absolutely make a mess of it entirely. You know, I don't know how many times I completely whiffed, you know, hit behind the ball, chunks, huge chunks, divots flying up, balls squirting here and there. But somehow I made around 18 holes, dude, but you know, I don't know how many strokes, maybe how many hundred strokes I had or something. It is just a complete mess, total mess. And yet he went out there and shot, I think it was like 5 under par. I think he shot a 67. And could have been a 65. I mean, he just completely torched the course. And like, I was in awe. You know, I just completely in awe. I said, "What?" But what happened was I realized it's possible to play this well, you see? Because I saw the first time I ever played golf, I was with someone who was like a pro, almost just like as good as a pro. I had no idea that he didn't say anything about it. He never even talked about it. But he was like super good. And, I mean, he just shot lights out, just crushed the course, just crushed it. So I was a witness to this. I witnessed this. I saw it firsthand. And then in my mind, I said, "Hey, it really is possible to play this game really well. It's difficult. You know, I've never played it, never been able to play it that well. But it transformed me in some way. I was transformed." And then what happened was I started paying attention to golf, all these good golfers are watching golf. I said, "Wow, how do they do that? How do they do that?" And so I became really, you know, and played a lot, practiced a lot, became very aware of it, even though I don't play very well, especially now. I always, in the back of my mind, said, you know, it is possible. Yeah, it's possible. I can see how it's possible. You have to have it all going on for you, you know, sure. You have to have your attention there, but it's definitely possible. So, same thing when you come upon a savior, bodhisattva, a guru, etc. In some way, you may just be floundering, you know, and you think, what can I ask them? What you know, what's going on? How can I make sense of this? And you know, you're just like struggling and floundering, like I did on that golf course. But I enjoyed it because it's like, this is kind of neat. This is kind of fun. You know, it was humiliating in some way, but not so bad. You know, I just like, huh, what an experience. You come upon one of these, you know, these great ones, and the ones who remember to laugh, and you're floundering, but you realize, hey, it is possible. They're doing it. I'm seeing it. They're doing it. They're not floundering. See, he wasn't floundering at all. He was in complete control. It was a beautiful summer day, you know, and it was awesome. He was hitting his shots, just crushing it, reaching all the par fives and two, you know, putting for eagle, and I think he probably made one of them. And just birding these holes and just crushing the course. And I was just like, wow, I mean, never been on a course before, never seen a person ever hitting golf balls at all. And here's this ball just, you know, going 280 yards, you know, straight, or hitting these iron shots that are just floating in the sky and just dropping down beautifully. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful to watch. So you see these great saviors, bodhisattvas, gurus, etc. And they have a beautifully abstract mind. It's just beautiful to watch the abstraction and just, you know, that everything's perfect. No worries, you know, it's just, wow. how they manage to function in this world and nothing bothers them at all. And here you are just completely floundering. Yet, you see, it is possible. It is possible. And then you say, you know what? I think I'm going to go to a driving range and start practicing. That's what I did. And started watching, you know, golf tournaments. I still watch golf tournaments. And I know, if for instance, if I wanted to take another body in this world, I wanted to focus on golf, and that was my focus, I know I could play as well as they play, for sure. Because I understand the focus and what it's all about. I just didn't have that focus, but it's certainly possible, absolutely is possible. You can be really dialed in. You can get really dialed in. If that's what you want to do. So the same things with these great ones, these ones, the saviors, bodhisattvas, gurus, etc., that you know, they're really dialed in to truth. And we can get that dialed in. Absolutely. It has to be what we want. But the alternative isn't so great. It's hell. The alternative is hell. The alternative is this double bind. And working on that double bind is hell. It really is. Trying to figure it out, trying to please this double bind, trying to make part of it true and the other not true, and defeat this and that, the struggle of good and evil, this double bind is hideous. And the only reason why we're not like these saviors, gurus, bodhisattvas and gurus, etc., is we haven't really focused in on it like they did. We haven't really, you know, paid enough attention, made it our priority. We still think like, no, I need to, at least, what we say is, well, first, I'll figure out a way to annihilate God, and then maybe I'll say, well, okay, I don't need to use that. I'll drop that. Once I make it real, once I find how to do it, then I'll drop it and then I'll be happy. See, everything's solved. No, it doesn't work that way. That's what doesn't work. But that's what we think that this will work. First make illusions real and then set them down. That'll never work. And this is what Jesus told me. This is what Jesus is telling everyone. That doesn't work. That's what doesn't work. First make illusions real and then set them down. Will never work. You'll still remain in this dualistic double bind. Dualism is another way to say double bind, actually. It's a double bind. Very bad, nasty double bind. Damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. It's like if we don't discover how to disempower God, we're damned. And if we do discover how to annihilate God, we're damned. It's a complete double bind. With annihilation as the present, you know, the present of this double bind. Okay. So of course we say, well, let me favor this side. Well, let me favor this side. And we always have some hope, like, well, maybe this will work, or maybe this will work. But always can we carry with us this, it seems like futility keeps catching up with us, or it's always chasing after us, futility, right? Annihilation is always chasing us. But if we just stop and laugh and see the whole thing as it is and just laugh, there's no annihilation chasing us. We're perfectly free. We're not in the least bit threatened in any way with annihilation. See, all this stuff we're working with here, bodies, etc., is a way for us to try and avoid spiritual annihilation, actually. That's what we're really afraid of. And there is no such situation. No concern whatsoever. Zero. So you can see these great saviors, bodhisattvas and gurus, they have it's not like they found a way to avoid it. There isn't any. See, we think we can find a way to avoid it. Yeah, it's real, but there's a way to avoid it. Yeah, that ocean of annihilation is real, but we found a safe harbor from it. We can just live here. No, it's not real. There's no reality to it whatsoever. And then we have a continuity problem. All is well. All is perfect. And we're not ready for, we say, I'm not ready for that. Well, then just catch that and recognize it and say, okay, the only problem I have is the continuity problem. I don't really have a problem with anything else at all, really. Not really. So then you listen, you pay attention, you hear, like I watch a golf tournament, I go out, practice, I play, I try to, you try to get the hang of it, you know? It's like, can I really get the hang of it? Practice, work at it. What I found in golf is that it's just like life, bigger life shows up there, and that I don't want to do too good. I don't want to be too successful. It's like, whoa, no, wait a minute. I'm afraid to start playing really well. It's shocking. So we're afraid of success, actually. Because if it's no problem, obviously, see, you know, where's the suffering? Where's the disempowerment? You know, there's got to be something we feel like we've got to be disempowered somewhere. So if I start doing well, then I say, whoa, I need to disempower myself a little bit here, so I'm going to mess up. I'm aware that I'm messing up on purpose, actually. I know I could make this putt, but I decided not to. So what happens is I become aware that I'm sabotaging myself. Absolutely. Golf points this out to you. You become aware you're sabotaging yourself out there on purpose. Most definitely. I remember a situation where I was going to shoot a 79, break 80 for the first time, and someone was there, a situation where someone didn't want me to, and if they did, they weren't going to play golf with me anymore, the playing partner, because they would feel like I was better than them. They didn't want to play golf with me anymore. That was the way they thought. So they wanted me to be kind of a bumbler out there, made them to make themselves feel better. Okay. So I had this easy putt, like a 5-foot putt. I know I could make it. I said, it's an easy putt, I can make it. But then I realized if I made it, I was gonna lose my playing partner. So I missed it on purpose. He still got mad that I shot an 80. And I didn't play with him anymore anyway, basically, you know. It didn't last much longer. It's no fun playing with somebody who wants you to fail so they can feel better, you know? You want to play with somebody who wants you to make the place. Come on, do great, because this inspires me. I want to be inspired, not if misery loves company. Like, I want you to fail so I feel better. Yeah, no, that's no fun. That's not the way. So hang around those who want you to succeed. They want you to succeed. They're happy that you do well. Oh. They see the putt go in, they say, wow, yeah, it's very doable. The hole is there. You know, it's amazing how that happens when you're playing with a group of people. Like, one person, the first person makes the putt, and everybody says, wow, the hole is there, that's great. You know, and oftentimes, like in a foursome, everybody will make their putt, because suddenly the idea that this pull is difficult vanishes somehow. This happens a lot. It's really quite amazing. And the same thing happens. If someone hits a bad putt and misses, they say, wow, how did I miss that one? Then everybody else will miss theirs too. Because they're thinking, oh, this is a difficult putt. But if the first one makes it and just rolls it right and says, oh, it's easy. This is a big hole there, no problem. Everybody else just steps up and knocks it right in. So like the savior, bodhisattva guru is like someone who just says, hey, it's easy. Not difficult, it's easy. You step right up, knock it in. Oh, okay. And people start feeling, oh yeah, I can do this. It's not that difficult. Now, is there that 100th monkey sort of situation? It's possible to some extent. Yeah, I think it's overstated. It's a magical thing that everyone will suddenly say, oh, wake up, you know, like that. No, you know, I'm not going that far. But you can still miss the putt, you know. But it does help. It helps when anyone is free here. It helps for those who want to be inspired. For those who don't, they don't like it at all. You know, they say, ha! I would keep playing with you if you missed that putt, but I'm not going to play with you anymore. Forget it. Yeah, okay, bye-bye. There are those like that, believe me, I've experienced it, who are like just hoping and praying that you screw up at every last shot. They hope you shank it out of bounds every shot. And when you hit a good one, they're like, I'm not talking to you. If you hit a bad one, then they're laughing. That's too bad you hit it out of bounds there, you know. And they're all smiley because you fail so miserably. It makes them feel a little better about themselves. There are those, absolutely there are. So they're, you know, they feel somebody has got to, their attitude, somebody has got to figure out annihilation and be, you know, annihilated. So it's you, and then you'll save me from it. You know, and this is like the idea of Jesus. Jesus was the idea of this was the disempowerment. In other words, Jesus was completely disempowered, found disempowerment, was experienced disempowerment, and that saved all the rest of us. Because they always say, well, Jesus did it, God, so don't annihilate it. You can't annihilate us. We'll take refuge in Jesus, because there's the proof. He proved it to you that annihilation is possible, and he annihilated himself. And so we're off the hook, you know, like that. There's that mentality, you see. So they want someone to be a complete failure. You know, they say, if you want to help me, you got to be a complete failure. Okay, that's not the way. That is not the way. It doesn't work. I've been there, done that. I was trapped in that. I wanted to help people get free of this problem. And they said, well, if you want to free me, you've got to then be the sacrificial lamb, a complete failure here. Which, you know, you need to find a way to disempower yourself, actually, so that then we can claim that we did succeed. And so God won't annihilate us and disempower us. And so I got trapped in that. And many have been entrapped in that. Maybe everyone here is entrapped in that, almost everyone. And I'm getting out of that now, getting free of the entrapment. They say, well, you're no savior then. You can't be a savior. Well, they're looking for a fake savior then, if that's what they're looking for. They're looking for a savior that isn't a savior, actually. And they will say, well, you claim that Jesus wasn't a savior. No, Jesus is a savior. But the idol that many have made out of Jesus is not a savior. The idol is not. But Jesus is a savior for sure. The idol that supposedly experienced disempowerment is not a savior, because that disempowerment never happened. The fact that a body dies is not disempowering the spirit at all, not one bit. But to believe that it is, then they think, oh yeah, okay, disempowerment happened. And then there, that's why now God is not going to annihilate this world, annihilate us. As long as we accept Jesus, we won't be annihilated. But those who don't will all be annihilated, right? This is the belief. This is making an idol out of Jesus and not hearing what he actually has to tell us. Again, another a guru, Sri Sri Anandamayi. She was asked, "Is all these problems that you've in this world, and just everybody demanding this of you, and just you know, just so many inconveniences, difficulties? Have you ever felt any upset, trouble? Ultimately, they're saying, have you ever felt disempowered in the slightest bit?" And she said, "No, not even the slightest bit." So I heard that testimony. I said, "Wow, I believed it." You get these testimonies from the saviors, the bodhisattvas, the gurus, etc. You know, there's other traditions that have different terms. I'm not going to bring everything, you know, use the term every time, but etc. It means all are included, all those who have not forgotten to laugh at the absurdity of this. It's like, wow, they're not disempowered. Even being in this world doesn't disempower them. They said, "What about getting old and getting infirm? And does that, are you inconvenienced, or do you feeling disempowered?" "No, not at all." She said, "That's only because you want to see this. You want to see an apparent disempowerment of what I am. That is why I appear to be getting old and infirm. But I'm not getting old or infirm or being disempowered in the slightest bit." See, that's what she said. I use the term she or he, because the body happens to appear in one way or the other, but it's really spirit. That's what spirit said. That's what reality said. That's what the guru said, actually. It's not really a he or she, it's a guru. It's a savior, bodhisattva, guru. Jesus is not really a he. Jesus is a savior. Sri Sri Anandamayi was not really a she, but a guru, savior, guru, bodhisattva, it's all the same, etc., etc. So again, the apparent disempowerment, same with Jesus, did you really die? No, that's what everyone wanted to see. That's what everyone wanted to see me crucified, actually. But was I disempowered by that? Not in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. So Sri Sri Anandamayi, living in this world for a long time, which actually tends to wear on you very severely, you know. It's one thing to be crucified at 33. It's another thing to live to be 86 years old during the 20th century, during all the storm and stress and wars and famines and troubles and everything, you know. And to be around so many intense situations of so many people demanding so much, demanding, so much craziness, a massive circus taking place, and not to be the slightest bit disempowered by any of that. That is quite extraordinary. It's another extraordinary example. See, Jesus gave a very extraordinary example. Sri Sri Anandamayi, very extraordinary example. And so I've benefited from both examples and other examples too. It's like, wow, that's extraordinary. Because I don't particularly want to be crucified or go through that. But most of us live in this world and we feel so disempowered by it. But here's someone who just lived among everybody, you know, and was not disempowered in any way. And again, all the supposed, everything, supposed sickness and aging and eventually dying and all that, he said, this is what you want to see. And so she didn't resist it. She says, this is what you want to see. Because you want to believe that the disempowerment is possible. Otherwise, you're going to be freaked out. So you want to see me getting older? That's what you're going. That's what you'll see. But that's not how she saw, how the guru saw itself. using the term she just for the purpose of talking here, but she said she saw herself as just this golden light, this glowing light, this beautiful celestial orb of light, so to speak, radiant light. Not aging at all, not being disempowered in the slightest bit by any appearance of the body at all. And I also said that she remarked that there are those who actually they reported this, that when they drop the demand for this apparent play of disempowerment, that her appearance of being aged vanished. And she appeared to be completely free of any age marks, any of the marks of age at all. Totally free of it. Not a trace of it. And she looked at him and smiled. Yeah. This is so. Yeah, they're just like, wow. I mean, that's a wow, okay. When you see all traces of age vanish like that, as if they were never there. They were never there. That's a wow. And yet there were those who were so advanced, they had those experiences with her. You know, there were some very advanced. I mean, just the willingness to see it, see that, that's very advanced. So miracles happen, tons of miracles happen, because the people were very advanced. They're willing to get this wow. Again, one time, a train was late, and she was late getting on a train, apparently, and was helping put all his luggage on. Someone like grabbed her when the train was moving, tried to lift her on the train, thinking they couldn't do it. Some old person grabbed her and pulled her on the train. So, and she was as light as a feather. There's no weight there. No weight at all, actually. No weight at all. Other people have experiences. There's no weight at all. And it's like, wow. So, these various types of what we call miracles or stuff are only happen because we're ready for them. So we can experience this wow, this wowness. But it's important that we don't get fixated on the wowness, okay? So we just say, okay, I'm not going to make too much of it. Just, it's wow. It's a big wow. Let me just sit with this. Maybe it'll take a while. But I'll just say, it's okay. I'm okay with this. I'm okay with this. But don't take this cavalier attitude like, oh yeah, I'm okay with this. And then go on. Because, no, the whole purpose of it is to trigger this wow. And you know, it's the good news, and this is profound. So you'll feel the profundity of it, absolutely. But don't try to make that profundity the end of it, so to speak, necessarily. Don't stagnate in it. Just don't make a big deal of it. But it's there. Wow, that was really quite an experience. All traces of age just vanished. This whole world is just an illusion. Yeah, wow. So the more of a culture of people who experience that, the easier it is for others to experience it, for sure. Because you might talk to somebody, hey, I saw that. They say, yeah, I saw that too. Or you did, yeah, absolutely. Is that profound? Wow, yeah. So why don't you just, you know, stay with this profundity for a while and get used to it. Let yourself settle down. Do some meditation. Take a few days of meditation and to get relaxed with this. Okay. See, nobody makes a big fuss. Nobody freaks out. Here, if you tell somebody in the culture like this, they're going to freak out. Oh, my God. Let's set up a shrine. Let's set up a pilgrimage. Oh, my God. You know. But there, it's just like, yeah, okay. A lot of us have experienced that. It's great, profound. So, but don't make a big deal of it. But don't be cavalier about it. I mean, it's a big deal, but don't make too big of a deal of it. This is the fine line, actually. So that's what those who are more advanced help out with. I say, yeah, it's a very big deal, but don't make too big of a deal of it, okay? like this morning, what I saw was a very big deal. But I'm just still saying, okay, all right. Recognize the continuity fear and just let it settle down. And they don't market it. You see, here, everything is all about marketing. Some venture capitalist hears about that. Wait a minute. I got to invest in this. This is an opportunity, you know, for venture capital to jump in into this. And, you know, maybe that's why I'm here. This is the home of venture capital in the world, actually. And maybe I thought maybe there's some way to, you know, to capitalize or something, you know. But no. That's a mistake. Over in more mature situations, nobody's trying to capitalize on it, really. Just okay, great. That's another wow. That's another opening. There's some more too, but you don't need to get to those right now. Just get used to this one opening, and then you'll be, and gradually, as Jesus says, you get many glimpses, more and more glimpses, until there's no more continuity problem really. And then the vision of oneness is just. It's just there. And you laugh, you've set this, you've exchanged belief systems is what you've done. So you certainly don't want to get fixated on one breakthrough, but you want to acknowledge the breakthrough, you have to. Otherwise, you will get mentally fixated on it if you don't full stop in the now, this wow. And accept the momentum of the situation. You then get mentally fixated with your thoughts. On where you're at. This happens to everybody. You know, you just have to get unstuck. We've all been stuck, and probably many times. I've been stuck my whole life, but I'm getting less and less stuck. But yeah, you can mentally fixate and say, oh wow, I need to capitalize this. I need to tell everybody this is it, and this is what I know. So I've had this breakthrough. Don't do that. You can just recognize the momentum. So this is great momentum, okay? But the goal is to recognize, you know, is to love everything that's ever happened. Forgive yourself with gratitude. Appreciate it all and say, I appreciate so much all this misery and everything that I've been through, put myself through. But now I see I don't really need it anymore. And so you honor your creativity, love yourself, forgive yourself, realize it's not necessary, remember to laugh at the silliness of it all, you know, and all of this needs to come to fruition. All this needs to come to fruition. So it's beyond words. It's beyond words. It's more profound than words. So you have to drop the mental structuring of everything. You know, just let us just sort of start, keep practicing, dropping it. Oh, I had a thought, I'm right. Oops, I forgot. Drop it. I have a great idea. I want to express, I don't have to express that. So, just let the structuring gradually, you know, not so important, whatever, you know, whatever. Don't have to structure it this way, don't have to structure it this way or that way. Ultimately, it's just a chuckle, see, and it's over. It's finished. So we tend to get trapped in all the structuring of religious traditions, various traditions, but the real goal is to go beyond even all that structuring. As they say in Buddhism, if you see the Buddha on the path, kill the Buddha. What it means is, when you're seeing a Buddha on the path, you're seeing your own structuring of a Buddha. That's your structuring. You want, it's an idol. It's an idol of structuring. You want to get fixated and stop there. So it means drop that Buddha. Drop that structuring. Drop it and just keep going. It's like that. So the full stop in the wow is you're feeling this unstructuredness. And just get used to that unstructuredness. Don't start attaching a whole bunch of structure to it. Say, oh yeah, I can fit this into this structure of religious structure or spiritual structure, this outfit. Now the whole purpose of the path is to get used to no structure. Reality, pure potential, doesn't have a structure, actually. structureless, formless, structureless. That is reality. So we must get more and more used to this full stop in the now of this wow, which is, wow, I feel, I can see that less structure. You know, I said, wow, as much, I got a glimpse of I don't need structure or something. Wow, just stop there. And, you see, the cat's running around everywhere. When it hears a dog going on the street, suddenly the cat runs towards me and hides behind me, you know. So when there's danger, you know, what do? We pray to God, don't we? But what do we do once the dog is passed? We go back out away from it and keep looking for more adventures like that, and, right? More danger, more troubles. What we need to do is stop seeking for problems. Stay with God. Stay with God. But the cat's always leaving again. The wise cat said, no, I'm just going to sleep here, right here. I'm not going to go searching for encounters and struggles and stuff. Just stay with God. You know, just stay with God. Yeah. So the lack of structure is what we need to get used to. So of course we use words to fill in the gaps because we're so freaked out about lack of structure that we feel we need some at least traces of structure. So that's why what I do is I try not to bring too much structure into it. So you get the flavor of it. A little framework, okay, so we don't feel, whoa, where am I? I don't know where I am. I don't have any structure. Where am I? Yeah. So a little structure. And that keeps, you know, adjusting a little bit, maybe a little less here, a little less there. It's like, you know, when you're playing with bubbles, blowing bubbles or something, you get this mass of all these bubbles, and then gradually the bubbles sort of pop, this one, they all go less bubbles, and then there's only three, now there's only two, and then poof, finally just goes into one, you know, and then finally poof, it pops, like that. The spiritual path is like that, it's like bubbles. We got all these bubbles, and gradually they tend to amalgamate into just one bubble, and then that two pops. So whatever you do, don't try to put any of this into some tradition of teaching. Say, oh yeah, okay, I think this fits into this tradition of teaching, or this structure, conceptual structure. Don't put it into any conceptual structure, because ultimately what we're getting is the wow. We're like, wow, I just saw formlessness. I just recognized formlessness. I just recognized no structure. Wow, just stay with that wow. Don't structure it. As best you can, don't structure it. Including don't structure it as silence. See, that's also a mental construct. See, the cat stays with me for a while, just kind of settling its nerves down, right? That's full stop in the wow. And now it's finally got its nerves back. Now it's out, you know, out in the wild world, out in the ocean there of samsaras, seeking more adventures. Off it goes. But it did stay for a while. But the purpose of calming down is not so that you can then go and try to make illusions real and then defeat them. It's to get more and more used to no structure. I don't need structure. Because only the notion of disempowerment gives rise to the notion of structure, which is ultimate. Structure is ultimately perception. We don't need perception. We don't need to seek disempowerment. All seeking is really seeking for disempowerment. So all we need to do is just let go of the seeking. We don't need to find disempowerment, and then disempower disempowerment. See, we think once we figure out how to disempowerment, then we can disempower disempowerment. No, there is no disempowerment. If we were disempowered, how can we disempower disempowerment? You know, it goes in circles, doesn't it? It's just crazy. So again, the wow is resting in that. It's sort of trying to be sort of neutral. It's not structure, nor is it a concept of no structure. It's not silence, not a concept of silence. We don't try to make anything of it in particular. We don't try to make anything of it in particular. Because God is nothing in particular, it's pure potentiality of all. You might say it's everything and nothing, but by saying nothing means it's nothing in particular. When people say, well, there's nothing, it's emptiness, well, no thingness. Well, it's nothing in particularness. Everything can be there, but there's nothing, no demand for any particularness. From the ground up which everything, which was giving rise to everything, there is no demand that it remain or that it not remain. So there's no demand for particularness at all in God. So everything is free. Everything is eternal life. Everything is eternal life. There's only eternal life, one eternal life. Always present. So what's the benefit of watching these videos is familiarity with less and less structure. Simple and simpler. Jesus says, just relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. That's all you need to do, nothing else. Just, so in other words, less and less structure. Phase four, less and less structure. Practicing that. Less and less structure. It's not, phase four is not some advanced structure, you know, more sophisticated. It's less and less structure. It's the experiencing of less and less structure. But we don't fall into the trap of quietism, which itself can be a very intense structure. This is more wowism than quietism. It's a realization of no structure. It's like, wow, I don't need structure at all. This is essentially what the wow is. Nobody needs structure at all. There's no need for it. No real need. No one has any real need for structure whatsoever. Never will. Nothing has any real need for structure whatsoever. Any particular structure. Nothing has any real need for any particular structure. There is no real need for any particular structure whatsoever. There never will be. See, now this just resulted in a very intense wow, very intense nearness to, you know, pure experiencing pure potential. So what you do now is fend off the backlash, fend off the structuring that tries to rush in. And it can be very insidious how it comes in and presents itself is non-structuring at first, and then it says, oh wait, and tricks you, tricks, 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 and before you know it, you're in a fantasy of structure again. So, but the longer you can hold out, the better. The more intensely you can hold out, the better. Even holding out for a little while is very helpful, just for a little while. Try it that way. Don't think, well, I have to try to hold out for hours here. No, how about like for a minute, you know, or just for 10 seconds or something. Just hold out a little while. Don't even counter. Just try to hold out a little while longer. No structuring. I had this dream experience where I didn't know where I was. I don't know where I am. I have no idea. That's very potent. It means that there's no structuring taking place. I'm not structuring of that there's aware. There's only everywhere. Even beyond that, this just is. This is eternal life right now. Where am I? In eternal life right now, right here, right now. That's the only place there is. Eternal life is the only place there is. We're already there. We're not really on some ocean of samsara seeking for some quiet harbor somewhere. We're in eternal life. We are eternal life. That's all that is right now. Reality doesn't have an explanation for reality. There's no structure we need to experience in order to experience reality. Reality is not a structure. It's eternal life. It's the allness. Is not a structure. There's no structure you need to experience in order to experience reality. And there's no structure you need to experience first. Like, first I need to experience this structure, and then that will, I can apply that to reality. No, there's no structure to reality. No determinant structure. It's pure potential, always. For all structures and all non-structures. You cannot say that there's a structure to it. So the mind is saying, where am I, where am I, where am I? And then what happens is we start spinning a story of where I am, you know, structure. Okay, this is where I am, this is my structure. Where's my structure, we're saying? Where's my structure? The I is just this fear of demand for structure. Where's a structure that I can claim is I? This is what I am. Oh, there's a structure. So this world is full of, we think it's full of structures. However, the dream was in this world where I was just walking along and I just suddenly realized, I don't know where I am. I had no idea where I was. And I looked around, I still had no idea where I was. I said, I don't have a clue where I am. Lots of different ways you can even practice this, but this is just arose spontaneously in a dream. Does anybody really know where they are? Not really. We think we do. Everybody's pretending they know where they are. Nobody knows where they are. There is no here. There's no structure to reality. Where I am is, I am in eternal life, is where I am. That's where I am. That's all there is. So maybe a very potent practice. I don't know where I am. I don't know where I am. And practice, I don't know where I am. Could be done with videos. Possible.